The most trusted name in news, this is CNN Radio.
It's a beautiful day. It's been snowing all this week, but the weather is perfect right now. I'm here in an old Corvette. I've been waiting to get out, and I've got a couple old muscle cars I enjoy. I get the T-tops off and drive around. This is the place where we explore history, politics, religion, culture. I'm Steve Rinehart. I'm your host. We're pleased to have with us today the curator of the Ancient History Museum in New York, David Hurst Thomas, one of the premier archaeologists in this country. He's going to be discussing Kennewick Man. Before beginning today's show, a quick word about local politics. The Utah legislative session ended 2 weeks ago with some disappointing results. Utah, which is widely thought to be the most conservative state in the U.S. and which has the highest percent of Republican voters in any state, we have liberal local legislators. If you want to get involved, and go to your caucus meeting this week. On Tuesday night, call your county elections registrar, find out where your meeting's being held. Go there. Delegates are elected at these meetings who choose the party nominees for November. Often in the off-presidential election years, only 5 to 10 people show up for these meetings. Take a few of your friends that live near you. You can be elected a delegate and have more influence over who the legislators are here in the state and who's running for your party in your district, and make some good. It does a lot better than just calling the legislators on the phone, who often just pay you lip service. Now, as I said before, we're pleased to have on Dr. David Hurst Thomas with us, the curator of the Ancient History Museum in New York. We're going to be talking about Kennewick Man. Quick introduction to Kennewick Man. Kennewick Man is the name for prehistoric remains found on the banks of the Columbia River in 1995, I believe. And they've been the subject of much controversy because they've dated to approximately 9,400 years old, which many scientists believe is too old to have any relation to the Native American Indian tribes in the area under the Native American Graves and Repatriation Act. I think it'd probably be better for me to let Dr. Thomas explain the whole background on the thing. Let's go to him now. Dr. Thomas, are you with us?
I am indeed. How are you doing, Steve?
Good. It's a pleasure to have you on the show. Thank you for coming on.
It's a pleasure to be on the show. I heard your line about the Corvette.
I enjoy these old muscle cars.
Well, I may be a curator at the largest natural history museum in the world, but I also have a 61 Corvette.
Oh, is
that
right?
I'm a Western guy who takes it out in New York and loves it.
Well, then it's that much more of a pleasure to have you on the show.
There we go.
Hey, I've read parts of your book, Skull Wars, Kennewick Man, Archaeology, and the Battle for Native American Identity. It's a fascinating book, and our users can get it on Amazon.com. We encourage our users to go there and listen to it. Before we want to ask you about how you got involved in archaeology, how you got interested in Kennewick Man, and what prompted you to write this book. Let's begin. First, tell us a little bit about yourself.
All right. Basically, I'm an overgrown Boy Scout. I grew up in the Bay Area in California, and I'm an Eagle Scout and went into the Order of the Arrow, and just thought studying American Indians would be about the coolest thing you could do. However, you had to make a living, so I was all set to go to medical school. But as it turns out, I went to UC Davis, the Cow School. And because pre-med's not a major, I ended up majoring in anthropology. I got to go on a dig class, and long story short, I realized I was going to be a lot better archaeologist than I was going to be a physician. So I changed. I got 4 degrees from UC Davis and came back. The first time I was ever east of Mississippi was my job interview in New York, and now I'm a curator at the American Museum of Natural History, the largest natural history museum in the world.
And you've written 30 books, edited 90 volumes, and more than 100 scientific papers. You're appointed a founding trustee of the National Museum of the American Indian, the Smithsonian Institution, and a member of the National Academy of Sciences. Tell us about Kennewick Man. When was Kennewick Man found, and how was he found?
Kennewick Man, the skull, rolled out of the sidewall, the bank of the Columbia River, in July of 1996. What they do, this is the upper Columbia in the Tri-Cities near Kennewick, Washington, and they have hydroplane races every summer. And a couple of local teenagers, enjoying apparently several adult beverages, were wading along the creek bank and just came up on this skull. they looked down, and it basically gave them quite a fright. They thought they'd come on a crime scene, and they did the right thing. They called the cops. And the county coroner, or the sheriff from the Benton County Sheriff's Department, came out, and he did the right thing, and he called the coroner. And the coroner came out and examined the find, and he did the right thing. He called a local archaeologist who examined the remains and thought they were relatively recent, maybe 100 years old, perhaps an early settler in the area. And he went back the next day and was able to collect almost an entire complete skeleton. He laid them out in his lab, agreed with his initial finding. Yeah, this guy's probably 100 or so years old. He looks like a settler. He's an adult male, probably in his 40s. But there was something unusual. He was running his fingers over the bones, and what he found was some kind of healed over something on this guy's hip bone. And he was worried about that, so he took it to the local hospital, and he had it x-rayed, and it didn't show up. Couldn't see what it was. So he went to the hospital, took it back to the hospital, and had a CAT scan done and saw that it was a stone spear point that was embedded in the hip bone of this supposed white European settler. He decided something, you know, why does a white guy running around 100 years ago on the Columbia River get blasted with a spear point that looks like it's 8,000 years old? So he sent off one of the toe bones to the best radiocarbon lab in the country, and the results came back 9,400 years old. It changed the life of the archaeologist. It put Kennewick Man on the map, and it's the reason we're having this conversation today.
And immediately, the Native American Indian tribes in the area claimed him as members of their tribes, including, oh, I don't have a list of all the tribes here in front of me, but it caused a large amount of controversy.
Well,
is that right?
It did, and it tells us something about the way that science is done in this country. When this archaeologist got the facts back from the radiocarbon lab, the first thing he did was call a press conference. And at the press conference, he announced that I have the oldest complete skeleton in the Americas, and we scientists are going to study it. That's when the five local tribes, it was led by the Umatilla tribe, but Yakimas and five other tribes, came in on this and said, wait a second. Scientists don't have the right to study that because that is our ancestor, and the 1990 NAGPRA law covers this. So the Corps of Engineers backed the tribal claim, and the bones were locked up, and scientists were not allowed to study it. The scientists sued, and we've been wrapped up in court until about 6 months ago.
And initially, the archaeologist who studied these before these Native American tribes laid claim to the remains believed that Kennewick Man showed Caucasoid features. Is that right?
Yes and no. The initial press statement that came out at that first press conference said that this was a Caucasoid man who was 9,400 years old, and immediately this was picked up by press across the country, the New York Times, the Washington Post. The New Yorker actually ran a cover piece on it that said, what is a 9,400-year-old Caucasoid man doing walking on the Columbia River? Everyone involved has since backtracked. The science writers made a mistake. The archaeologists made a mistake. It's bad science. There's no such thing as a racial history that goes that deep in time. So there was a great deal of misunderstanding that somehow a European had come to America and, been wiped out by Indians who came later. There are all sorts of stories that came out.
If you search for Kennewick Man on the Internet, you'll see pictures of what he used to look like. It looks just like Patrick Stewart from Star Trek.
Yeah, yeah.
And then President...
Incredibly bad science.
Now, President Clinton had the area where he was found covered with 350,000 tons of landfill and rock so the people couldn't further explore over there. Is that right?
Well, it's not quite as egregious as that, but there may be some truth to that. The land actually falls under the control of the U.S. Corps of Engineers, the Army Corps of Engineers. And as the controversy was heating up, certainly, there was a great feeling in the White House, because in a different regime, about the importance of cultural relativism and particularly minority rights and whatnot across this country. So that administration was very interested in advancing Native claims, and I'm very sensitive to that kind of thing. One of the claims that was going on the Olympic Peninsula, the Macaw Indians got the right to hunt a whale. the legal right to hunt one because they've done that in the past. There's a quota on whales, and the Japanese agreed to give up one of their whales to let the macaw go out and do it. Greenpeace and a number of environmental groups came out and said, you can't do that because the whale is an endangered species. So there was an immediate face-off between tribal interests and ecological interests in this country, and the Clinton White House came down very strongly in terms of cultural diversity and native rights. That's what happened at Kennewick, that the order went out that the Army Corps of Engineers was going to pour all of this by helicopter, all of this debris, on top of the Kennewick site to, quote, protect it. What it actually did was destroy it. It was very reminiscent of Vietnam, about destroying the Vietnamese villages in order to save them.
Tell us about NAGPRA. NAGPRA, what is it? It stands for Native American Graves Protection and Repatriation Act.
That's right.
And now, what does it do? What does it say needs to be done when sites like these are found?
Well, basically, it's a piece of legislation that was signed in November of 1990 by President Bush 41. And it's recognizing that Native American people have a special stake in the history of this country. And it's also recognizing that over history, major museums in this country have acquired things that probably are inappropriate. So what it does is lay out several categories of things that have to be discussed with Native tribes, and it sets up a series, and the things are human remains and grave goods and sacred items and what are called items of cultural patrimony, which mean that stuff that a tribe would have owned that no individual had the right to give away.
Dave, we have to take a quick commercial break. Stay with us. It's a two-minute break. We're speaking with Dr. David Hurst Thomas, the curator of the Ancient History Museum in New York. Phone lines are open. Salt Lake 254-5855, Provo 470-5855, Ogden 670-5855. We'll be right back. This is KTOK.
AM 630, KTKK.
Choice Humanitarian, a Utah local nonprofit, creates real change for the real world. Villagers are working to pull themselves out of extreme poverty. To see their stories, visit choicehumanitarian.org or call us at 474-1937. You can be a partner with Choice by volunteering your time, your money, or your skills. To find out more, visit us at choicehumanitarian.org or call us at 474-1937. Consider helping us help the world by calling 474-1937 or visit our website, choicehumanitarian.org.
Listen, did you know, after many years of research, hypnosis is the most enjoyable, quickest way to stop smoking and could be the least expensive? With hypnosis, you have fun and enjoy what you're doing while you quit. How can you beat that? Call 261-1441. To quit, call Robert Shaw, the Stop Smoking King at the Salk Hypnosis Center. You can stop for the rest of your life in a little over an hour. Phone 801-261-1441. He used to smoke. He called 261-1441 to quit.
We're back. This is K-Talk. I'm Steve Rinehart. This is the place where we tell you everything you never knew you wanted to know. We've got Dr. David Hurst Thomas with us on the phone, the curator of the Ancient History Museum in New York. We're talking about Kennewick Man. He is the author of Skull Wars, Kennewick Man, Archaeology, and The Battle for Native American Identity. Great book. You can get it on Amazon.com or order it through your local bookstore. I'm sorry to have interrupted you there, Dr. Thomas, with that commercial break. We have those that come up periodically.
I know how that works.
Well,
we were talking about NAGPRA.
Right, exactly. Right.
And basically what it is a legal solution to a social problem. It's a way that requires museums all over this country to look at their holdings, and if they are inappropriate things, according to the law, that belong to tribes, then the onus is on the museum to notify tribes and figure out a way to, quote, repatriate the artifacts. Now, part of NAGPRA also is about new finds, and so there are certain rules about what happens on Indian land, what happens on federal land, and so on. But they're particularly on a new find. The skull rolls out of the cut bank of the Columbia River in July of 1996. The issue is it a Native American skull? And if so, is it affiliated with a modern tribe? And that's the criterion under the law. First of all, is it Native American? Secondly, is it affiliated with a modern tribe? And that's the NAGPRA process. And that's what the court suit was about.
NAGPRA has been criticized by some people who believe that it confuses religion and science by forcing science to recognize as fact the religious views of Indians, which sometimes there's no scientific evidence to support those views or conclusions by the Indian tribes that these scientific remains belong to them. In your book, you discuss numerous examples of instances where scientists have lied and taken advantage of Native American Indian tribes. But I wonder if that's justification for enacting statutes like these. Let me illustrate the problem I have with NAGPRA through a hypothetical. Now, this show is broadcast in Salt Lake City, Utah, and here in Utah, 70% of the population is Mormons. And Mormons believe that two waves of Jews settled America, one in 3000 BC, another in 600 BC, and that these settlers shared Mormon religious beliefs, and that even they were Caucasian until they were wiped out. And there's very little archaeological evidence to support these views, but those are the views held by the majority of the people here. Now, what if the Mormons went and said, we're an Indian tribe? You know, we have these beliefs about how America was settled, and started trying to lay claim to archaeological finds made around the United States. I'm sure that people would be very upset about that. Scientists would be very upset. But we allow the Indians to do that without any more evidence than anyone else would have for these finds. I mean, do you see a problem there?
I think you've raised a very interesting question. And there are a couple of key points here. The first is that NAGPRA is a little more complicated than the way you represented it. What it's doing is setting out criteria for determining cultural affiliation. And your argument there, your hypothetical, would be that these remains would somehow be affiliated with modern Mormon descendants. Now, there are criteria for this in the law, and what the objection is, and you hint at it here, is that Native oral history is part of the equation, as is scientific evidence in terms of archaeology, in terms of linguistics, in terms of what we know about dating, and you go, but oral history is a player in there, and that's what the law has broken new ground there, and it really gets at some issues of the old European British statutes of right of possession. But what the law reads is a preponderance of evidence. So you take, I think it's 7 or 9 criteria, one of which is oral history, and puts that into the mix. And preponderance of evidence is not without a shadow of a doubt. It means 51%. So it puts into play an odd kind of a legal discussion. And if you were going to go with your Mormon hypothetical, then the analog would be, what if you took, of 9 criteria, the Book of Mormon, as one of those 9? It would still have to be balanced off against scientific evidence, linguistic evidence, and the other things I reeled off.
Now,
that's the first thing.
Okay.
But the other issue is the misconception that somehow NAGPRA is about, and Kennewick Man, is about religion versus science. That's not true. It's about power and control. And what the tribes are trying to do is get control of their own history because it's ended up in so many museums. Now, I'm unaware that that's an issue in Mormon country. Maybe it is. But it's about who owns the past and who owns the specific remains that survive of that past. And the major museums around the country, and I work in one of these, we've spent a lot of time out digging up sites and not talking to Native people because we, the scientists, own them. We have a law 100 years ago, in fact. The 1906 Antiquities Act gave the right of possession to all Native American sites in this country on federal land to the Smithsonian to judge who gets to dig them up. And who gets to dig them up are people like me with PhDs, card-carrying anthros. What about the Native people whose sites those are? They were written out of the law formally, and what NAGPRA is doing is giving us a way of redressing that balance. But it's not about religion and science, because 1 out of every 10 Indian tribes in this country has its own archaeology program now. So the issue is not archaeology and science.
Dr. Thomas, we have to take another 2-minute commercial break. We'll be right back. This is K-Talk, Select 254-5855. We're talking to Dr. David Hurst Thomas, the curator of the Ancient History Museum in New York, about Kennewick Man. We've got a couple of callers we'll get to when we get back from the break. We'll be right back.
Come join us at the Best Western Cotton Tree Inn in Sandy. Whether it's a romantic getaway in one of our honeymoon suites or a weekend family outing relaxing by our 24-hour pool and hot tub, everyone will be sure to enjoy our full hot breakfast, served with eggs, hash browns, Belgian waffles, French toast, fruit, pastries, and much more. We also offer fresh baked cookies, free high-speed wireless internet, a fitness center, and shuttle service. We are conveniently located by many shopping centers and numerous restaurants. Call for your reservations today, 801-523-8484. That's 801-523-8484. Be sure to mention a K-Talk Radio listener special discounted rate of $69. Best Western Cotton Tree Inn is located at 10695 South Automall Drive in Sandy, 801-523-8484. Call for your reservations today, 801-523-8484. That's 801-523-8484.
We're back. I'm Steve Rinehart. This is K-Talk. We explore cultural issues, archaeological, religious, political. We're talking to Dr. David Hurst Thomas, the curator of the Ancient History Museum in New York, about Kennewick Man in a book that he's written, Skull Wars, Kennewick Man, Archaeology, and the Battle for Native American Identity, available from Amazon.com. We've got a couple of callers that we'll go to in just a second. Salt Lake 254-5855, Provo 470-5855, Ogden 670-5855. I wanted to ask you really quickly, Dr. Thomas, John McCain wanted to introduce an amendment to NAGPRA that would actually reduce the need to prove that these remains were related to the Native American tribes.
No.
Isn't that right?
No. John McCain and before him, Senator Ben Nighthorse Campbell, before he retired from Colorado, wished to introduce a two-word amendment to NAGPRA. And it came out directly out of the difficulties arrived at Kennewick. What I mentioned before, the statute, the NAGPRA statute, has two parts. The first is to decide whether or not it's Native American, and the second is to decide, if so, is it related to a modern tribe affiliated. And the problem is that the court in the circuit court in Portland, Oregon, conflated those two issues, and they used the criteria, oral tradition and whatnot, for establishing affiliation to decide whether it was Native American or not. That's the law of the land right now, but I doubt that it will stand. And what this legislation is suggesting is not, the definition as it reads in the statute says that a Native American is someone who is related to a modern Indian group. And the addition, the wording that McCain wants to put in is or was, because it includes groups that are now extinct. And if you look at a map of Indian tribes across this country, there are a lot of them that just aren't here anymore.
But wouldn't that serve to make any remains found part of a Native American tribe?
Absolutely not.
No.
And if you look at who supported this, the Society for American Archaeology, which is the premier archaeological association for professional archaeologists, supported that change because it is consistent with the initial spirit of the legislation, which was a compromise.
I see.
The only objection there was that it was put in as one of these riders to a huge body of legislation instead of debating out the issue. But the Society for American Archaeology supported that, and it was only defeated when the Department of Interior came out against it.
We've got a caller on line three. We've got Dave in Orem with a question for you. Dave, are you with us?
Hi, yeah. I just was wondering about any kind of evidence stating the race of a skeletal remains. Why was it bad science for it to not be a Caucasian type person?
Yeah, that's a good question, Dave, and it gets right to the heart of the whole thing. I write textbooks in archaeology, and we're having a flood of kids coming in to take archaeology in college because they see so many of the forensics programs on TV right now. They're so popular, all the CSI stuff. And there's nothing wrong at all with looking at modern, at a crime scene and trying to determine the appearance of that person from those remains. And you could even, although there is no such thing as race in a scientific way, you could have these various categories that you could predict almost certainly what that person looked like from a finger bone, from a very small bone fragment. And the reason we can do it is because it's backed up by databases that are hundreds of thousands of individuals that have been examined in the last 50 years, 100 years, where you know what the face looked like, you can go back and see what the bones look like and work back and forth. Very accurate science, even though mistakes are made. There were huge mistakes made in the Oklahoma bombing, for example, trying to do that. But generally it works. If you take it back 100 years, it might work. It'd be pretty close. You take it back 1,000 years, the databases fall apart because we don't have any of that kind of comparison. And if you take it back 9,400 years, it's just wishful thinking. That we have no idea what the face of that Kennewick person looked like from the bones because there have been huge changes. There have been major climatic changes. There have been huge dietary changes. There's no reason at all to expect that person to look like American Indians 100 years ago, and even if they were, we couldn't prove it. That's why it's bad science.
Is there pressure on anthropologists studying Kennewick Man and other similar sites from traditional archaeologists and from Native American Indian tribes to downplay features or characteristics of the archaeological site that might contradict traditional notions about how the Americas were settled? Is that something that...
pressure? Now, that's an interesting question, the way you phrased that. The way, to me, the neat thing about being a scientist is that I have the privilege of being wrong. That I express my ideas in terms of hypotheses, and then we go out and subject those hypotheses to data. And one of the best things that can happen is if your hypothesis is wrong, because you've phrased it in a way where you can be wrong. The privilege of being wrong. I've been wrong lots of times in my career. That's what makes science work. Religion, on the other hand, is about belief. And if you're a firm believer in, whether it's a Native American religion or you mentioned the LDS religion, or you can pick out any of the others, that's a fundamental difference from science because no amount of empirical evidence is going to prove that you're wrong.
Sure.
So, coming back to your question, we should be happy that we're getting new evidence that shows, I've written 5 books about the Bering Straits theory, about how people came over from Siberia 12,500 years ago and populated the North and South America, and they went down to the plains and they created this site. All of that's wrong. All those books are wrong, and that's a good thing because that's what keeps science different from religion.
So you don't believe that the Americas were exclusively populated by people crossing the Bering Land Bridge?
Exactly. I think the evidence right now suggests that was very simplistic, and it's discounting a number of things that we understand about the way in which the world works now. And probably the best example is we've known for 10 or 15 years now that the continent of Australia was inhabited by people about 50,000 years ago. Now, there's no amount of moving sea levels up and down and the Bering Straits appearing and land bridges and all that that's going to hook up Australia to southeastern Asia. It's clear that the people who got to Australia 50,000 years ago got there by boat, and they navigated for days and days out of sight of land, and yet they showed up with a breeding population that created the first Australians. That knowledge was available long before we're talking about the peopling of North and South America. So there's no reason at all that people had to walk across the Bering Straits, that you had to keep your feet dry. It opens up all sorts of possibilities.
What does Kennewick Man tell us about the settlement of the Americas? Do what we know for sure about him fall in line with current thinking by archaeologists about how America was settled?
I really don't think that Kennewick rocks the boat that much that way. There are scientists, and some of this is in the Time magazine that's on the stands this week, the cover story, who would argue that you can look at that skull and hook it up with, say, modern Polynesian populations or Ainu off of Japan. In other words, that the skull is a highway into the history of the human past. I don't, for reasons I said a minute ago, I don't believe that. I think the skull does have a genetic component, but I also believe it is subject to evolutionary impacts that make some kind of racial classification, which was big-time anthropology 100 years ago. obsolete today.
Dave, hold on a second. We have a two-minute commercial break. We'll be right back. So, like 254-5855, Provo 470-5855. Talking about Kennewick Man with Dr. David Hurst Thomas.
AM 630 KTKK.
If you find yourself pregnant and you're scared, I've got some advice because I've been there. My boyfriend wasn't ready to be a father, and frankly, he wasn't all that interested after I told him I was pregnant. Some people told me my parents would help take care of the baby, but my baby still wouldn't have both a mom and a dad of her own. And that's really important to me.
Adoption, it's about love.
I didn't give my baby up. I gave her more.
A message from LDS Family Services.
Pick up in the front lot.
Good credit means the absence of money.
I'm a big fan of money. I like it. I use it. I have a little. I keep it in a jar on top of my refrigerator.
Paul, does this make us rich?
Oh, no, not rich. But we're certainly better off than we were before.
Bad credit means the end of it.
Where's my money?
Hi, Mark Marine here with Marine Credit Systems, the car dealership where you kick the dealer, not the tires. You've heard me say, don't sign blank documents. But what about what you should sign? The paperwork seems to be endless. Trade-in paperwork, title forms, odometer slips, as-is sheets, bank contracts. Here's what I want to do for you. You can pick up a free package of all the documents needed to be signed in a car deal from me at Marine Credit Systems. It's all there, just so you know what to look for.
Wow.
Go to markmarine.com or call Marine Credit System, 467-9980, 467-9980.
We're back. I'm Steve Rinehart. We tell you everything you never knew you wanted to know on this show. We talk about culture, history, politics, religion. We have Dr. David Hurst Thomas, the curator of the Ancient History Museum in New York. It's a privilege to have him on this show. We're talking about Kennewick Man, NAGPRA, other archaeological issues. We've got a couple callers who we'll get to in a second. Tell us, Dr. Thomas, are there other archaeological sites that have been found that didn't that weren't as controversial as Kennewick Man, but that are equally as important that people in the mainstream aren't aware of?
You bet. Good point. And let me give you one example that's featured in the New Time magazine piece that's on the newsstands right now. It's called On Your Knees Cave, and it's on in the islands off of southeast Alaska, not too far from Juneau. Now, here are some human remains that were found by archaeologists. They're about 600 years, we think, older than Kennewick Man. But immediately, because of NAGPRA, what the scientists did who found these human remains is notify the local Tlingit tribe. They recognized the power and authority of the local tribe. And because the archaeologist had established relationships with the tribe, because his kids went to school, they were learning the language and whatnot, they could sit down and work through the difficulties of power and control and ownership. And as a result, we've had a terrific program going there for 10 years where we have the native people involved with the archaeology of their own past. So On Your Knees Cave is one of the most important finds, and it didn't have to go to court like Kennewick, and it didn't have to go through, as it turns out, all the court-mandated restrictions of Kennewick. You don't read about it in the papers because nobody was arguing, but scientifically it's just as important. And the point is, once you recognize that it's not about science and religion, it's about power and control, we can all work out this stuff. And we've got Tlingit Indians standing up to have DNA testing done, 200 Indians, so that they can determine whether or not they're related to those remains.
What are we learning from this cave? Is it shedding light on archaeological questions?
Yeah, it is, and it goes back to the one you asked me before, that in all the old cut-and-dried textbooks like I write, where we read that the first American came across it 12,500 years ago walking across a land bridge, what we know from the isotope studies from the remains at On Your Knees Cave that we still don't have for Kennewick because of the court issue, we know what that guy ate. And what he ate was a marine diet. And what we're learning now is if we're going to look for these first American routes, they're probably making an end run and not going down the heartland of the country, but they're probably going down the coast. And it's these marine environments that are going to give us the earliest remains.
We have Gary on line two with a question for you. Gary, are you with us?
Dr. Thomas.
Yeah.
Hey, I got a question. Just being here from Utah, what is probably the most important archaeological find ever found here in the Utah area?
Oh, I spent a lot of time in your state, and that's tough to narrow that down.
Oh, really?
Yeah, cool. You've got some incredible archaeology in the state of Utah. If we're talking about the early end, which we are now, I would say Danger Cave out near Wendover. That was excavated in the 50s by Jesse Jennings, who was a professor at the University of Utah. And it really showed us remains that are almost, well, they're older than Kennewick. There were just no human remains there, but it really showed how Native people lived. The other thing I'd say is the new work that's being done out at Range Creek, that is incredibly important because it's so well preserved, but it's on the other end of the spectrum.
That's
with the agricultural
ranch, right?
People.
The one ranch that was that the one ranch where the guy sold the ranch to the state or something like that?
Yeah, right. And there's some amazing archaeology that's going on out there because the sites are so well preserved. So we're learning a lot about the Native American people 200 or 300 years ago before European contact.
Hey, don't they find guys like in the mud of like the Utah Lake and Salt Lake Basin? Like guys that when the water gets low, I mean, can't they find people like in the bogs or something like that?
Well, they're not exactly bogs, but as the Salt Lake goes up and down, sometimes it's eroding out remains, and there have been a number of studies done up toward Provo showing, in some cases, hundreds of Native American people who had been buried there, and because they were so well preserved by the water, there was an agreement between the tribes, the local tribes, and also Utah State, and Weber State to come in and do a joint project where they would move the remains because they were eroding out, but also allow the scientific study to be done. It's another one of these examples of cooperation.
That's awesome. Hey, thanks, Doctor.
Hey, Gary, thank you for the call. We appreciate it. Let's go to David on line three. David, are you with us?
Yeah. What was your guest's name?
It's David Hurst Thomas, Dr. David Hurst Thomas. He's the curator of the Ancient History Museum in New York.
Oh, okay. What's he a doctor of? What are you a doctor of?
I have 4 degrees of anthropology.
Where did you get them at?
I got them at the University of California at Davis.
David, do you have a question or comment about Kennewick Man or archaeology?
Yeah. So you're a curator at a museum now?
Yeah. Hey, David, we appreciate the call. We have a lot of people standing by. If you have a question about Kennewick Man, you're welcome to ask it.
Oh, well, I just want to know his credentials, that's all.
All right. Well, he's one of the premier archaeologists in the country. We're happy to have him on the air. Those of you who are interested in buying his book, Skull Wars, can find it on Amazon.com.
Where's the kid?
Let's go to another caller named David. We're getting a lot of callers today named David.
David's your chief today.
And Sandu, are you with us?
Yes, Dr. Thomas?
Yes.
Yes, with the recent flap in the news about the DNA and the Native American Indians, I guess that had, Alaskan origins. What is your opinion regarding the settlement of this country? Does it look like the majority of the people that did come here may have come across the land bridge? And is it true that the DNA did affirm that, that there are Native Americans and did have their origins in Asia?
Yeah, we're at a tough place right now because our information comes from so many sources. Part of it's the archaeology, part of it's the bioarchaeology, as with Kennewick Man. Part of it is with linguistics, and part of it is the molecular archaeology, the DNA. And they don't all agree. We don't do science by democracy, but if we all held up our hands, I think most of us would say that most Native American groups came from southeast or from Siberia in that area, maybe Lake Baikal and across. However, there may be several other groups that came across, and there's a curator, one of my colleagues at the Smithsonian, will argue very strongly that the first Americans actually came from France.
From France?
Yeah, the French connection.
They found a pouch of drugs.
Yeah. But if you look back at the time period, if we're going back 15 or 20,000 years ago, we're in the teeth of an ice age. And if you would look at the climate at the time, it is solid across the Atlantic, the other side. It's solid ice from about Virginia over to France. And if you have small skin boats, not only could you make it across there, you could make it across there two or three times.
Mm-hmm.
And there are some artifact similarities with the southeast, and the oldest radiocarbon dates we have are from the southeast, that suggest that that French connection might not be a nutty idea, although a bunch of my friends think it is.
Sound like you're keeping, true to the scientific spirit, you're keeping an incredibly open mind. So you're willing to say that more than likely most of the people did come from somewhere from Siberia, from, you know, that quadrant of Asia, but you're just open to many possibilities.
Well, I think we're open to what the data will tell us.
Mm-hmm.
And from a selfish point of view, as a guy who makes his living as an archaeologist, this kind of uncertainty is not a bad thing. I like to call it job security.
one last quick question. There was an LDS bishop. Oh, I'm not LDS, so I don't want you to think that I'm have an agenda here. He was an LDS bishop in, I think, Sydney, and I'm trying to think of his book. Apparently he was a molecular geneticist, and he bought into the conclusion quite thoroughly, you know, about the DNA studies, and it caused him to rebel. He wrote the book, and he was excommunicated from the LDS Church. Are you familiar with that Dr. Southerton?
Really not. Sounds unpleasant.
Yeah. Okay. Hey, thank you very much.
Hey,
okay.
Hey, Dave, good questions. We appreciate the call. Thank you for calling in.
Thank you.
Let me ask you quickly,
yeah.
Dr. Thomas, a couple of controversy archaeological sites. We had an archaeologist on about a month ago who talked about the Bat Creek inscription found in Tennessee. Are you familiar with that site?
I do a lot of work in that part of the world, but I'd have to say that I'm not a specialist on it, but I do understand how it's viewed in my field.
What is the consensus among the scientists in the America about the Bat Creek inscription?
In a word, bogus.
Mm-hmm. Is that right? We have to take a quick commercial break. We'll be right back. We have Dr. David Hurst Thomas, the curator of the Ancient History Museum in New York, with us. We only have 6 minutes left in the program after this break. Solic 254-5855, Provo 470-5855. We'll be right back.
KTKK.
Hi, this is Cam Williams, spokesperson for Alternative Medicine Referral Network, inviting you to join me as we learn more about you and your health choices to a great show called It's About Health. This and every Saturday from 11 a.m. to noon, we will be discussing complementary health care such as transage, Reiki, naturopathic doctors, acupunctures, and many healing modalities. Interviews with local providers Dave from Dave's Health and Nutrition, Patty Reese, holistic practitioner, Alex Hogan, Water Wellness, national providers such as Dr. Donald Jolly from the Whitaker Wellness Institute, Newport Beach, California. I can promise you will learn more about you. If you want to learn a little bit more about Alternative Medicine Referral Network, go to amrn.net. Listen in every Saturday from 11 to 12 noon.
The Alternative Medicine Referral Network would like to invite you to the Alternative Health Summit 2006, being held March 24th and 25th at the University Park Marriott in Salt Lake City, Utah. Meet and discuss current alternative medicine approaches to cancer, diabetes, allergies, stem cell research, as well as other topics like diet and nutrition, herbs, and massage therapy. For information and to register for this exciting event, call 1-888-726-7670 or log on at www.amrn.net. Enjoy and educate yourself with free product demonstrations, biofeedback sessions, bone density testing, as well as seated massage, antioxidant testing, morning Tai Chi sessions, and free product samples. The Alternative Health Summit 2006 is the first of its kind to bring together alternative medicine practitioners and medical doctors so that you may benefit from the many options available to improve you and your family's health. For information and to register for this event, call 1-888-726-7670. Again, 1-888-726-7670 or log on at www.amrn.net.
Welcome back. I'm Steve Rinehart. You're with K-Talk. Solic 254-5855, Provo 470-5855, Ogden 670-5855. We've just got a couple of minutes left in the program. We have Dr. David Hurst Thomas with us, the curator of the Ancient History Museum in New York. Very happy to have him. The coming weeks, we're going to have on politicians running for some of the House districts here in Utah. We're going to be interviewing them about immigration and some other political topics. Going back to Dr. Thomas, it's interesting. Most of the people here, most people in America know so little about archaeology that they hear only about the fascinating and see in it what they want to see. You say that the Bat Creek inscription is bogus. It's something that a lot of people are interested in around here. Is it probably a forgery? Is that the consensus among most of your colleagues?
Yeah, that seems to be the thinking. It was found at a time when the Smithsonian was out trying to resolve what is called the Mound Builder controversy. And I grew up out west, and I wasn't really familiar with this, but it captivated east of the Mississippi America, because there are tens of thousands of burial mounds. And the question is, did Indians build these, or was this some long-lost civilization? And so the Smithsonian had this huge group that went out all across and dug up all of these. They were the very best scientists in the world. And the reason that the Bat Creek inscriptions were so important is because this august scientific group found this rock with what were considered at the time to be Cherokee symbols, and later were looked at as being somehow old world, you know, coming over and representing a sort of a Paleo-Hebrew contact. And because it had the endorsement of the Smithsonian, it took off. There are a couple of things to say about that. One is that the Smithsonian published its stuff. It's out there for everybody to see. The original specimen is on the mall. Actually, it's out in Siouxland, Maryland, but anybody who's interested can go and study it and express their own opinions about it. That's the importance of museums, that we've got the real deal, and people can take a look at that. The other thing is that it gives us a chance. Science, we're going to say what we think the best evidence is, but what we shouldn't be doing is squelching the other opinions. We have it with the Vikings in America, which were considered, in my word, bogus for a long time. We now have the site in Newfoundland. We know for sure that the Vikings showed up 1,000 years ago, and we know for sure that the first Christmas was celebrated in Newfoundland 1,000 years ago. But that was considered skepticism. It was heretical 50 years ago. That's why these things need to be brought up and they need to be discussed.
Where can our listeners go to find information out about archaeological sites, important archaeological discoveries? Is there a place on the internet that you would recommend?
Yeah, what I would do is recommend getting, I don't have it in front of me, but it's the website for Archaeology Magazine. And they have kind of a breaking news thing that comes on every week that gives you all the information, and it will provide even minority opinions about, gee, somebody says this, even though the majority of scientists say something else.
Well, we encourage our listeners once again, pick up a copy of your book, Skull Wars, Kennewick Man, Archaeology, and the Battle for Native American Identity on Amazon.com. It's been fascinating having you on the program, and we are very grateful that you took the time out of your busy schedule to come on and answer some of these questions for us. We have one final caller we'd like to get to in just a second. Quickly, do you have any final comments about Kennewick Man for our listeners? Anything you'd like them to remember?
I think the bottom line on Kennewick, we have the science, and that's going to come and go, and we're going to have isotope studies and the dates and that sort of a thing. But the real issue here is there's a place in America's past for everybody. And if the LDS community is feeling slighted, then they have a way to express their opinion. The Native American community has felt slighted for a long time, but they're now players too. And we scientists have a side, but we don't own the past.
We appreciate you coming on once again. Maybe we'll have you back sometime.
This was fun. Take care of that vet, okay?
You as well.
Yes, for sure.
Thanks again, Dr. Thomas.
Okay, my pleasure.
Next week, we are going to be discussing another archaeological issue next week, and the weeks after that, we'll follow up with some political topics. We'll be having candidates on from the House districts talking about local political issues. Important for us all to keep in mind, important for us all to remember.
TKK.